McGraw-Hill Audio presents Succeed on Your Own Terms, Lessons from Top Achievers Around the World on Developing Your Unique Potential. Written by Herb Greenberg and Patrick Sweeney. Narrated by Patrick Sweeney.
This book is an interior travel guide into the hearts and minds of individuals who've succeeded on their own terms. The individuals we're about to introduce you to have succeeded by knowing who they are, understanding the qualities that drive them, playing to their strengths, overcoming their limitations, taking advantage of their defining moments, and having their own definitions of success. During the last 2 years, we've traveled to over a dozen countries and explored with hundreds of successful individuals questions such as, what are the qualities that distinguish them? Do they simply have more energy, drive, focus, vision, and luck than the rest of us? Or do they also have something above and beyond that, something truly exceptional? Is there one particular quality shared by all successful individuals? And how can we recognize our own defining qualities and tap into our own inner strengths? Along the way, we learn much about the qualities that distinguish and drive people who are succeeding on their own terms and how we can recognize those qualities in ourselves. Through in-depth interviews and insights gleaned from analyzing the comprehensive personality assessments they took, we will provide a one-of-a-kind look into people who are at the top of their game, succeeding beyond their wildest dreams. From entrepreneurs to star athletes, from inventors of products to impassioned social workers, from mountain climbers to uncompromising politicians, we will take you behind the scenes and give you a real understanding of what motivates people who have a clear sense of purpose, meaning, and personal fulfillment in what they're doing. We will share the inspiration and insights we've gained along the way about how winners see themselves, how we can identify and develop our own unique qualities, and how we can prepare for our own defining moments. Do such individuals even know what makes them tick and keeps them going? Do they recognize winning qualities in others? Did they always know they were meant to take on their signature challenges? Do opportunities for success keep presenting themselves or come around only once? How do they overcome adversity? What keeps them awake at night? And ultimately, how do people at the top of their game define their own success? As we explore these questions, we'll introduce you to some of the incredible people we met, including Rebecca Stevens on how climbing Mount Everest became her all-consuming goal, Paul Schulte, a Paralympic wheelchair basketball player, Samuel Pisar, a Holocaust survivor who went on to become a prominent international lawyer, Ben Vereen, the actor who tells us how he overcame the defining moment of losing his daughter, Senator Barbara Boxer, who talks about the importance of standing up for what you believe in, even when you know you can't win, Muggsy Bogues, the shortest NBA player of all time, who shares how he overcame the odds, and Congressman John Lewis, the legendary civil rights advocate, who spoke at the historic March on Washington just before Dr. Martin Luther King made his I Have a Dream speech. But allow us to step back for a moment and share some quick background on who we are and what motivated us to write this book. Caliper was founded by Herb Greenberg nearly a half century ago to advise companies on hiring and developing employees, building teams, coaching executives, managing performance, and on virtually every aspect of ensuring that organizations have the people and systems in place to succeed. Our basic premise has always been that when it comes to succeeding, an individual's potential is far more important than his or her experience. Don't look to the past, look to what is inside of someone. The assessment instrument Herb developed is the Caliper Profile, which is one of the most accurate tools currently available for reading an individual's motivations, strengths, and potential. This assessment is the foundation for our consulting approach, which has helped over 25,000 companies around the world, including Avis, Johnson & Johnson, and some of the fastest-growing smaller firms to assess, hire, and develop the talent of more than 2 million applicants and employees. From individuals being considered for their first jobs to presidents of companies and everyone in between. It is our hope in writing this book to share what we've learned about people who find success on their own terms. These significant lessons have important meanings for individuals and corporations alike. Among the key findings we discovered is that inside of all successful individuals are four things: a defining quality that sets them apart, a moment that they each call their own, a clear definition of their own success, and they love what they're doing. We hope some of the stories and insights from this book will help you broaden your understanding of what success really means and provide a roadmap to help you find your own success, Whether you're an executive looking to hire employees who can grow with your company, or an individual looking to change your life's direction. Chapter 1. You've got to know where you are to know where you're going. This book has been a truly collaborative process, from the conception to the interviews, to the assessments, to uncovering the patterns of success, to the writing. In this chapter, however, since we are focusing on Herb's own journey of success, it seemed appropriate for modesty's sake to have it written by me. I first met Herb over 2 decades ago at a forum that Brendan Byrne, then the governor of New Jersey, hosted on a subject of creating jobs in a tough economy. At the time, I was the governor's speechwriter, and I came to know Herb as a bright, engaging, committed entrepreneur, brimming with ideas and energy. While he was blind, he didn't let that hold him back at all. I wasn't exactly sure what his firm did, but I understood it had something to do with helping companies identify and develop their professional talent. When I left the governor's office, Herb offered me a position heading up marketing and corporate communications for his consulting firm. That, as Humphrey Bogart says at the end of Casablanca, was the start of a beautiful friendship. One of the first things I learned was that when it came to being interviewed by the media, Herb had only one request. He didn't want to talk about being blind. His concern was that such articles almost always take a slant of blind guy does well, and that was not how he wanted to be perceived. Instead, he was much more interested in talking about his ideas for new projects and possibilities. So I always respected his wish, and as I got to know him better, I can honestly say if you asked me to come up with 12 words to describe Herb, blind would not be one of them. And that was that. Then about a year ago, he and I were racing through an airport. Time, you learn with Herb, is not to be wasted. Every minute is to be squeezed for all it's worth. We placed our carry-on bags on the conveyor belt, and as soon as I started guiding Herb through the doorway that detects metal objects, alarms went off. The guard asked Herb to sit down so he could scan him with the metal detector. As I moved forward to escort Herb toward the chair, the guard motioned for me to stay back. Then, realizing that Herb was blind and not wanting to offend him, the guard stammered, "I'm sorry, do you have trouble seeing?" Herb replied, "Well, I can't see very well." And I just started cracking up, saying, "Herb, that is the most upbeat explanation of being blind I've ever heard." When I told his wife, Sunny, this story later, she shook her head and started laughing and said, "That's Herb." In all the years we've known each other, Herb had provided very few details about how he lost his sight, so on the plane ride, I decided to ask him to tell me what it was like when he went blind. As we eased back for a long flight, Herb shared with me how he learned to accept certain things about his life, but not others. When I was 9 years old, I suddenly became very ill from an infected mastoid, a cranial bone right behind the ear. I was burning up with fever, so my parents had to get me to the hospital for an operation right away. My condition was quite serious. They were told that there was a very strong possibility I could lose my hearing and that there was even a chance that I might die. Now, you also have to understand that my parents were already in excruciating emotional pain at that time. About a week before I was rushed to the hospital, my baby sister Rosalyn had died from strep throat. I can't imagine what they were going through, and the thing is that penicillin was introduced about a year later, which could have cured both my sister's strep throat and my mastoid infection. But what can you do? Well, Herb's operation appeared to be successful. He left the hospital weighing only 35 pounds. "I just felt too weak to do anything," he said. "I was extremely susceptible to infection, and some sort of virus hit my eyes." Slowly, over the course of that year, as he got stronger, his vision faded. I can remember waking some mornings and seeing little spots in front of my eyes, little black dots. But they would go away when I rubbed my eyes, so I wasn't especially concerned. Then one day, and I'll never forget this, Herb recalled, I was reading a book to my dad from a Don Sturdy series of adventure stories. You probably don't even know him. He was like Jack Armstrong or Tom Swift, a hero kind of thing. Anyway, as I was trying to read, my father noticed that I was holding the book upside down. What was going through his mind at the time? It was very confusing. It just wasn't making sense anymore. There were all these black marks and dots on the white paper, but I didn't know what they meant. I could only remember what we read out loud in class. So his father rushed Herb and his upside-down book to a doctor who removed any doubt about what was happening. I can remember him saying, "Your son is going blind." Herb paused as he remembered. It was a slow process, very gradual. There wasn't any one crushing moment when I thought, "Oh my God, I'm blind." And I don't remember crying or asking, "Why me?" or what am I going to do? I just kept adjusting. I kept trying to look closer and closer at things, and honest to God, I didn't realize, except for the black dots, that anything was wrong. It didn't really hit me until one of the follow-up doctor visits when I heard him say, "Your son is now blind." Over the course of the next year, Herb and his parents alternately challenged and accepted what was happening. They got him Braille lessons right away, but I found memorizing to be a lot easier, Herb recalled. In fact, he claims to have never taken a note in all his school days, from elementary grades to getting his Ph.D. His intensity, impatience, and anger merged to defy a well-meaning but inept educational system that wanted to send him away to a special school for the blind. There were three distant schools he could attend, but his parents would have nothing to do with that. They were not about to let their young son be sent away to school. He had just lost his sight, and they didn't want him to lose touch with his family. They were determined to make sure he would live at home, but more important, they wanted Herb to attend a regular school with regular kids. They didn't want him to be segregated because of his blindness, and they clearly understood that their young son felt the same, since he told them in no uncertain terms, "If you let them send me away, I'll break every window in the building." So Herb was basically homeschooled while his parents sorted out the situation with the authorities, resisting enormous pressures to send him away to a facility for the blind. Finally, at the end of the year, a representative from the Board of Education came to their house with news that a school in Brooklyn, PS 93, had a Braille class, and Herb could attend there for the next year. Looking back on that year, Herb views his parents' strong stance as a turning point. "If they had caved in and sent me away to a school for the blind, I have no doubt, particularly back then, that my options would have been very limited, and my life would have been completely different," he said. One of his fondest adolescent memories was being a Boy Scout. Lionel Goldman, then the Scoutmaster of Troop 271 in Brooklyn, created an environment where Herb felt accepted, challenged, and just one of the kids. "By allowing a newly blind boy into his troop, Lionel gave me a chance to make new friends and do things I would never have done otherwise, including spending 4 summers at the camp of Ten Mile River. Lionel was one of the first people outside my family who was comfortable with my being blind. He didn't view it as something that should hold me back. I'm eternally grateful to him for that." For Herb, what is it like being blind? Can he see anything at all? "Right now, I can make out just a bit of light. Today's a very sunny day. It's very bright, and I can sense some light. I know the sun is over there," he said, pointing upward and somewhere to the west. "Light and shadows, however, are about it. I don't see any color," he continued, "just bright and dark areas. I can't see shapes, not really. I can sense there's something there, but if I was walking along and not expecting to see it, I'd bump into it. When I really try to focus, though, I can see something, in effect, blocking the light. There's a painting in the Philadelphia Museum of Art by the Impressionist Edgar Degas. It is his last known work. At the time, he was then almost totally blind from the paint pigments he had rubbed unwittingly into his eyes. The painting is done entirely in shades of red because, as the curator explained, red was the last color he saw." I asked Herb if that made sense to him, and he said, "That's interesting. I'm not sure if it was that way for me. But I do remember some colors quite well. Red is one of them. I can also envision blue, but it's harder. I can sort of imagine green, and I have a vague notion of purple, but I can't tell you what they would go with, so don't ask me to match your clothes for you. Now that you mention it, though, of all the colors, red remains the strongest in my mind." Often when I'm with Herb, I hear people marvel at his accomplishments, not the least of which is founding a global consulting company with over a dozen offices worldwide and an enviable list of clients, including Fortune 500 companies, fast-growing smaller firms, and even professional sports teams. But their admiration usually culminates with something like, "And what's even more incredible is that the guy is blind." How does Herb feel about that? "I don't like it," he said definitively. "It makes me feel uncomfortable. You know that. The truth is that everyone has some kind of disability, and it frustrates me that I can't do certain things I know I'd enjoy, like playing basketball. I love sports, and I'd love to play on a team, but my disability ruled that out. The reality is that being blind can be limiting and very annoying. When I was younger, I was denied certain jobs because I was blind, and there were certain girls who wouldn't go out with me because I was blind. There was one girl I cared a great deal for and who liked me too. We'd gone on a few dates, but then her parents put a stop to it. They wouldn't let her go out with me anymore. All that hurt. It really hurt." As he reflected on how as a teenager he was rejected by some girls and even by some of their parents simply because he was blind, the psychologist in him considered how rejection can paralyze some people while causing others to carry on with even more determination. That triggered a memory of how he'd experienced prejudice in the job market because of his disability. As a 25-year-old who'd received a PhD with highest honors from New York University, Herb was excited about making his mark on the world. He'd already consulted over 3 years with the New York City Department of Welfare, so he was primed for a new challenge. He'd sent over 600 applications for positions around the country, ranging from teaching to social work to consulting. Within a week, he received 85 encouraging letters inviting him for an interview. When contacting his potential employers, Herb made them aware that he was blind, and in short order, the 85 potential interviews were reduced to 3 actual interviews, resulting in no job offers. "Now that's rejection," he said. How did he come to terms with that kind of rejection? "I certainly didn't dwell on it," he said, then added, "I honestly believe that I've been able to succeed in my career not exactly in spite of my blindness, but because I was blessed with a creative mind. My parents gave me a solid sense of self-esteem, and I had some incredible mentors along the way. I've also experienced my share of failures, quite a few of them. I tried many things that did not work out before succeeding with Caliper. So it's not so much about overcoming being blind, it's more a matter of overcoming the hurt that comes from being rejected because I was blind. Somehow I was always able to use that hurt as a motivator to try even harder." Eventually, Herb was offered an assistant professorship at Texas Tech. After his second year, he remembers one incredibly hot night in July of 1957 when a reporter called and informed him that the Texas Tech Board of Directors had voted not to renew his contract. Herb was stunned since he had just been offered a sizable salary increase by the chairman of the department. It turned out Herb was being let go because he was giving speeches around the state on his PhD dissertation, which was that segregation in education could not create equal opportunities for those who were segregated. His outspoken liberal views apparently offended most of the university's board members. When Herb was offered his next teaching position at Rutgers, the head of the psychology department said the reason Herb was fired from Texas Tech made him an even more appealing candidate for the new teaching position. "When you're in the wrong place," Herb said, "you can't turn yourself inside out to try to fit in. You've got to be true to yourself. You can't let them get to you. You've got to believe things will work out for the best." Ironically, years later, Herb received a settlement from Texas Tech, which was enough for him to put a down payment on a summer home. While teaching at Rutgers, an insurance company approached him with a consulting project. They wanted a thorough review of all the psychological tests available at the time to determine if any of them could predict whether an individual had the potential to sell. 3 months later, he wrote them a memorandum which basically said there was nothing like that in the marketplace. That's when the entrepreneur in him kicked in. He sensed an opportunity and with a colleague spent every spare moment developing a personality assessment that could determine whether an individual was motivated to sell or to manage others or to provide customer service or to lead a company. In August of 1961, Herb resigned from his teaching position, confident that he and his partner were onto something. Together, they borrowed $15,000 from a small stock brokerage firm and started Caliper. Even back then, Herb said, $15,000 could not support a startup business and 2 young families for very long. Just as they were about to run out of funds, an executive from General Motors decided to take a chance on Caliper's approach to assessing potential and predicting job success. That gave them the breathing room they needed. The premise of Herb and Caliper has always been to look for that which is not so easily seen. When Herb was interviewed most recently in the Harvard Business Review, he was asked, "Do managers overemphasize or misread visual cues when evaluating people for jobs or promotions?" He responded, "Most people depend too much on their sight. How does someone look? Do they fit the part? Some of those visual cues can be as superficial and inaccurate as, 'She seems to carry herself like a leader,' or 'He looks like he would fit in with the rest of the department.' That first impression then becomes the context for the rest of the information they gather about an individual. They may hear the person's responses differently because they like what they see, or because the person is smiling convincingly at them." Then he added, "A hiring interview is a very unnatural way to meet someone. Applicants can impress you with the homework they've done on you and your company, and it's not hard to convey an enormous amount of enthusiasm for just an hour. So you have to delve below the surface, try to get a sense of their character as well as what they've learned from their accomplishments and their failures. Try to get at what is genuine. The key to hiring and managing people is to find out what drives them. One of the most important questions to ask is why. This is not something you can see visually. You need to ask the right questions and then really listen. When Herb was asked, "What sorts of non-visual cues do you notice?" he responded, "The proverb says the eyes are the window to the soul, but I think it's the voice." People can work on their smile. They can convey a certain look. There's so much plastic surgery these days that someone can actually buy a certain look. But voices are genuine. You can tell if a person is comfortable with you, not putting up barriers. Or you can tell if there's no reaching out in a person's voice. When someone's voice is flat or quiet, you don't have any idea what he or she is thinking or feeling. That can be a warning flag. Herb makes an extra effort to pay close attention to the voices of those around him. Is there warmth there, genuine enthusiasm, sincerity, or do people sound uncomfortable with themselves or with others? He said you can hear cues in their voices. Are they really interested? Are they thinking about something else? Or are they trying too hard? Here's an interesting experiment to try. Concentrate mainly on people's voices. Do it for a full day. Then see if you can describe the voice of someone you really care about and the voice of someone you don't. I can't help thinking that Herb may be hearing the same things I'm hearing but is paying a different kind of attention. Does the loss of one of your senses improve your others? I can't tell you for sure. I don't really have anything to compare it to, Herb said. This is probably an issue that is impossible to prove one way or the other, but how else can one explain Herb's uncanny awareness of time, distance, and direction? He has a memory for phone numbers like a Rolodex file and can get you from here to there better than MapQuest. Whether or not it's because he can't see, he seems to have a compass and a clock built in. Here's just one example. We were driving from the airport into downtown Miami to speak at a convention, and we were on in less than an hour. Herb had stayed at our hotel before, but I hadn't. "Head south on A1A," he said. "How far?" I asked. He smiled and said, "Don't worry, I'll tell you." Oh, great, I thought. I'm driving with a wise guy who can't see, and I don't know where in the world I'm going. So I said, "Just give me a hint. Is it 20 minutes away?" He responded, "I'm the navigator. I know where we're going." Knowing how to take a hint, I stopped asking, and we continued planning the last-minute details of our presentation. With Herb, there is no time like the last minute. I was in mid-sentence when he interrupted me with, "Where are we now?" I looked around and said, "At a light across the street from a Texaco station." He said, "No, I meant, what street are we crossing?" I told him, and he said, "Fine, we're only about a half mile away." How did he do that? On one level, he seemed engaged in our conversation. On another level, he had an accurate grasp of the geography, and at the same time, he had to have been calculating the speed at which we were traveling. I asked him, "How did you know exactly where we were?" He replied, "It's not that I was thinking about it all that intensely. It's just peripheral. I'm aware of the same things you are, but in a different way. While both of us were involved in the conversation, you were probably also looking around at the scenery for landmarks or whatever. Right? You're not concentrating on it. It's just part of the background. I'm more aware of the road, the turns, and our speed because my energy and attention are not wasted taking in the scenery." It makes sense. I've seen him do the same sorts of things in subway systems in Chicago, New York, and London. Directions are more than just getting from point A to point B for Herb. "I've got to know where I am," he says. "Definitely. I want to know if we're on the right track. Are we getting lost? Are we okay? I need to know because most people don't have a clear sense of where they are or where they're going." Maybe it's a control thing, but somebody's got to know where we're going and what's happening, and I feel better if it's me. I pointed out to Herb that it sounded a lot like his management style. "I hadn't thought of it that way, but I think you might be right," he said. "I don't want to tell people what to do all the time. I just want to know what's going on and that we're moving in the right direction. Tell me what's happening. If it's good, that's great. I always love to hear positive things. If it's bad, let me know and we'll fix it. But I can't know whether we're on track or have a problem until I know where we're headed and what the plan is for getting there." He paused, then added, "But it's all about knowing directions. It's about knowing where you've been and where you're going. I like to know the design. What's the layout? Then I can contribute something. But a lot of people just figure they'll kind of meander along and find their way, and they never get anywhere. I need to know the plan." Herb's strong sense of place may come from having grown up in Brooklyn. Several people we interviewed for this book had grown up in Brooklyn, and beyond having moxie, they all shared a strong sense of belonging. For instance, when we met Senator Barbara Boxer, she and Herb immediately launched into reminiscences of Brooklyn. I'd been in this position before, and I knew that if they got around to the subject of the Dodgers leaving, I wouldn't be leaving anytime soon. When two people from Brooklyn first meet, they typically play a game of naming streets and places. It's like a test, as if someone might actually fake being from Brooklyn. They ask about Juniors, then Ebbets Field, and then Borough Park. In the senator's case, she went to Wingate High School. Herb went to Bushwick. Whatever Brooklynites go on to become, and no matter where their journey takes them, they know where they're from. Their shared pride wells up when they meet, and you can tell they're okay with one another. Being okay with one another brings to mind a key point about Herb and trust. Establishing trust is a challenge for everyone. It's at the heart of any meaningful relationship. You realize just how important trust is when you walk with someone who is blind. When a blind person is on your arm, they must trust you to look out for them. You're their guide. Where's the wall, a door, the steps? Is there a curb? Are you sure you're paying close enough attention, watching out for both of you? Even when trust is established, Herb says, he still feels a strong sense of self-preservation. Whenever I walk with him, he always wants to link his left arm inside my right arm. It's just a pattern, and I never gave it much thought until one time when we were rushing through an airport and I went to tuck his other arm inside of mine. He went out of his way to switch positions. When I asked him why, he explained that even though the last fistfight he was in was as a kid, he still likes to walk with someone on his left so that his right hand is free to swing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.